really we should clap for Catherine's artwork. It's such a, so fantastic. If you don't, not for me. If you don't know this, that Catherine Tilley, those were her hands, that's her art. She teaches art at Wheaton Academy, and she's done lots of things. Some of you have seen this before. Years ago, she showed me her journal, where she keeps notes when someone preaches. When I preach, or Pastor Brian or Sterling preaches, she journals. She draws her sermon notes. I was so blown away by that. I thought, that's way better than my sermon. We've got to put that on the screen. So I just wanted to, it's exciting to share with you the creative and the passion and energy that she has to bless all of you, because that's really a snapshot of where we've been since September in the story of God. Looking back over all that we've been discovering about who God is and what he's done in our lives, bringing us up to this point. And when we were laying out this sermon series way back in the summer, I remember thinking, like, if we could work out the schedule that Passover, Exodus chapter 12, the Passover, would fall on Palm Sunday, the day before we come to the table here on Thursday and Good Friday, and come to that table, that would be perfect. And it worked out. God worked it out. So here we are. I'm very excited. I know that you are like, most of you come here going, oh, what are we talking about today? But I geek out about this stuff, and so it's fun to share it with you. Years ago, when I went with a number of people from our church over to Russia, at that time we supported a sister church, the First Transfiguration Baptist Church of Samara, Russia. How's that for a good name, right? We went to visit them, and they were celebrating 100 years, their centennial. They had outlasted communism. And they were celebrating 100 years of their church, and they asked for a delegation to come. Pastor Brian was senior pastor at that time, and he couldn't go, so they got sort of the JV. They got me and a couple other guys. And we went over there to help them, because we had supported them for many years. And one of the things one of the indelible memories of that trip for me was this dinner one night after the celebration. We went back to Pastor Victor's home. Actually, it was one of the elders' homes. He was there. Some of the elders in the church, some of the men and women that were longtime members were there, and the Pastor Victor, and I was there as a guest with a few others of us. Crammed around this table with this meal. It wasn't the meal. Russian food is terrible. But it was the stories. We sat around this table, and they told these stories about God's faithfulness in their church for 100 years. Some stories they experienced, some that they had heard passed on to them from their mother and or grandmother or grandfather. And I just, it was all being said in Russian, and the translator was whispering in my ear. I remember feeling so privileged to be there as we ate this meal and shared. They would break out into hymns in Russian, and I would like, yes, I don't know what we're singing, but it's about Jesus, you know? And I would just listen to these stories, and I remember walking away going, that was a sacred thing, to sit around this table and hear stories of people talking about God's faithfulness over generations. And we do that in our own culture in different ways. Meals to commemorate things, right? 4th of July, it's being corrupted by our commercial culture. Thanksgiving. And in our faith, we come now to the story, the central story, the central moment for Jewish faith and Christian faith, the Passover meal. And for Christians, the adapted Passover, the Lord's Supper. The centerpiece of our faith is this meal, which symbolizes something that we're to remember, we're to re-engage in frequently. Something about God's grace and faithfulness to us over generations. At the center of our faith is the story of the bloody sacrifice of an innocent substitute. It's pretty unique. That's what Passover is. That's what the Lord's Supper is. Now, this idea is somewhat offensive to people in our culture. What? The center of our faith is the story of a bloody sacrifice of an innocent substitute? That sounds barbaric. That sounds a little out of date. I'm not sure about that. In fact, Christopher Hitchens, some of you may know that name. Christopher Hitchens has passed away now, but was sort of one of the leading figures, not sort of, he was one of the leading figures in what was called the New Atheism. Atheism in general, of course, the belief that God doesn't exist, which I always found curious, like, why organize around something that doesn't exist? Unicorns do not exist. My house, 7 o'clock, we're having a meeting, right? It's like, why are we doing that? But the New Atheism was simply saying not just that God doesn't exist, but that Christianity and belief in God is dangerous for the world, and we need to actively oppose it. And he was one of the leading figures in that. He famously said that, and I'll quote him here, "I submit the doctrine of vicarious redemption through a bloody sacrifice is utterly immoral." It's calling God immoral, basically. But yet it's here, at the center of our faith. I mean, we were just singing about four songs in a row that talk about blood. If you're not inside the Christian subculture, that's a little weird, isn't it? If you walk in, like, what's going on with these people? Lambs and blood? I thought we're in the 21st century here. What is all this about? How do we make sense of it? So I'm going to read to you a portion of the story in Exodus 12, and then we're going to walk through and try to unpack it at the table together, understanding the center of the sacrifice and the symbols. Exodus chapter 12, verses 1 through 14. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, "This month shall be for you the beginning of months." By the way, God is reorganizing their calendar theologically. He's saying, I'm changing the way you mark time now by this meal, this remembrance. We do that in our culture, right? B.C. and A.D., or if you're in school now, B.C.E. You can call it what you want. It's still organized by the same central figure. And you know who that is. It's not C.S. Lewis. Verse 3, "Tell all the congregation of Israel that on the 10th day of this month, every man shall take a lamb according to their father's houses, a lamb for a household. And if the household is too small for a lamb, then he and his nearest neighbor shall take according to the number of persons, according to what each can eat. You shall make your count for the lamb. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a male a year old. You may take it from the sheep or from the goats, and you shall keep it until the 14th day of this month, when the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill their lambs at twilight. Then they shall take some of the blood and put it on the two doorposts and the lintel of the houses in which they eat it. They shall eat the flesh that night, roasted on the fire with unleavened bread and bitter herbs, they shall eat it. Do not eat any of it raw or boiled in water, but roast it, its head with its legs and inner parts. And you shall let none of it remain until morning. Anything that remains until the morning you shall burn. In this manner you shall eat it, with your belt fastened, your sandals on your feet, your staff in hand. You shall eat it in haste. It is the Lord's Passover. For I will pass through the land of Egypt that night, and I will strike all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast. And on all the gods of Egypt I will execute judgment. I am the Lord. The blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you. And no plague will befall you or destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. This day shall be for you a memorial day, and you shall keep it as a feast to the Lord throughout your generations, as a statute forever. You shall keep it as a feast." Skipping to verse 21. "Then Moses called all the elders of Israel and said to them, 'Go and select lambs for yourselves according to your clans and kill the Passover lamb. Take hyssop and dip it in the blood that is in the basin and touch the lintel and the two doorposts with the blood that is in the basin. None of you shall go out of your door on this house of his house until morning. For the Lord will pass through to strike the Egyptians. And when he sees the blood on the lintel and the two doorposts, the Lord will pass over the door and will not allow the destroyer to enter your house to strike you. You shall observe this rite as a statute for you and for your sons forever. And when you come to the land that the Lord will give you, as he has promised, you shall keep this service. And when your children say to you, 'What do you mean by this service?' you shall say, 'It is the sacrifice of the Lord's Passover. For he passed over the houses of the people of Israel in Egypt when he struck the Egyptians, but spared our houses.' And the people bowed their heads and worshipped. Then the people of Israel went and did so as the Lord had commanded Moses and Aaron. So they did." This is a strange story. Maybe it's familiar to some of you from Charlton Heston and the Ten Commandments. Maybe you know it from the Prince of Egypt cartoon. But if you really read it and think about it, deeply about it, it's a strange story. It's mysterious, it's beautiful, and it's wonderful, but it's not always comfortable. In verse 23, "The destroyer," Moses says, "is going to pass through the land." One of the things that's strangest, but we take, maybe it's familiar to us and we don't catch it. What is the destroyer? The angel of death, it's sometimes referred to. The most devastating, awesome force in the universe is not a hurricane, a tsunami, a flood, an earthquake, or a fire. It's nothing made by man. It's not a nuclear warhead. The most devastating, destructive force in the universe is the divine judgment of God on people who have rebelled against him. It's irresistible, complete. And here on this night, God is saying, for a brief time, going to give a limited taste of what the awesome power and divine judgment is like. And what then protects us from the most devastating force in the universe? A lamb? A woolly quadruped? A lamb is our protection, is our covering. It's strange, if you think about it. And now again, the idea of judgment and sacrifice, that's not comfortable. I confess it. It's not always comfortable to preach it. It's difficult. We don't like to hear that. I've had people say to me, I believe in the God of the Bible. The God that I believe in is exactly like the God of the Bible, except without the judgment, without the wrath, without all that stuff. And many of us would like that, right? We think we would like that. I would like that this part of the God, but not this part of God. We think that's okay to do with God. But husbands, for a minute, could you do that with your wife? The wife that I like to think of is not my actual wife. It's mostly her without this part, right? How would that go? In fact, try that at home this week. Take out the best photo of your wife and Photoshop in the things you think she needs and out the things you think shouldn't have. And then go to her and say, this is really who I think of you as. Tell me how that goes this week, right? Now, most of you are like nervous laughing because your wife is next to you. And your wife's like, stop talking, Pastor Jeff, right now, right? Why? It's cringeworthy, and you should cringe because it does violence to the true beauty of your spouse as who she is. You don't get to pick and choose that. You married her for who she is. But we think we can do this with God all the time. There's an objective reality to who God is. He's revealed it to us in His Word. But many of us think, well, I prefer not to think about this part of Him. The first thing, I want to give you three things to remember and one thing to behold. I know behold is a churchy word, but we'll explain that as we go. Three things to remember. The first thing to remember is this, the severity of God's mercy. Remember the severity of God's mercy. The Bible is clear to us from beginning Genesis all the way to Revelation that sin or rebellion against God always leads to death. Always, without fail, it leads to death. It just doesn't always happen in this shrunk down period of time like this. If God created you in His image and gave you life and made you for a purpose to live your life in service and worship to Him, then to reject that, which is sin, to live apart from that, would invariably, necessarily, by definition, lead to the opposite of life, death. Now I want to be very careful here because when we talk about Passover in Egypt, we're talking about the death of children and infants. And some of you in a room this size have experienced that pain. So I want to say clearly what the Bible is not saying and what I am not saying and would never say is that somehow the death of children is the result, direct result of parents' sin. No. That would be a horrible lie. It's not what the Bible teaches. What I am saying is that all injustice and suffering and death and evil in the world is the result of sin in the world, the brokenness of our world. How many of you watched the news this week? You could hardly look at the screen and saw what's happening in Syria. People trembling from chemical attack. I can't even see it. Children. Parentless now. That's not God's judgment on them, but it is the result of a broken world. People that have, all of us, have contributed in some way to the brokenness in the world that God wants to redeem and restore. Remember what G.K. Chesterton famously said when a newspaper in London put out a question and invited the leading philosophers and thinkers and scholars and writers in Britain of the day to answer this question: what's wrong with the universe? And they all wrote in these long, thoughtful, rambling diatribes on their philosophical opinions. And Chesterton famously wrote in, "Dear sir or madam, I am. Sincerely, G.K. Chesterton." That's his answer to what's wrong with the universe. I am. All of us, in different ways, have rejected the perfect law of God. In fact, in verse 22, Moses says, "Don't go out of your houses." Why? Because even though the blood is over your doorpost, none of us could stand on our own merit before the divine judgment of God. Nobody can. You need to stay underneath the covering. In fact, in the Passover Seder, that's this Passover meal which has been added to and used as a tradition down through the centuries for the Jewish people. Part of what they do, and it's mentioned in the text, bitter herbs. The bitter herbs now, they will dip in salt water for a reason. Bitterness, to remind themselves of the bitterness of their bondage and slavery. Salt water for the tears shed in their bondage. This symbol, for the Jew, refers back to once upon a time. For Messianic Jews and for us, this symbol means not once upon a time some people who aren't related to us were in bondage, but we are all in bondage. There's a bitterness to all of our lives apart from Christ. There are tears we all shed and should shed. So remember the severity of God's mercy. The second thing that we remember is remember the sacrifice of God's substitute. Remember the sacrifice of God's substitute. Sinclair Ferguson, who's a theologian and scholar, writes about this. He says, one of the common misconceptions of the gospel is this, that God loves me because Jesus died. He says, this sounds right to our minds, but you don't think about it. He says, that's actually a corruption, and it's really dangerous. Because what happens then? If God only loves you because Jesus died, what does that mean? Somehow Jesus had to convince God to love you. As if the God the Father and God the Son are sort of at odds. As if God's going, he's wrathful. How many of you have thought this? The God of the Old Testament is angry, and he's out to get sinners, and then Jesus comes along, and he's sort of in the way going, no, I like them. Don't hurt them. That's not what the Bible presents to us. God the Father does not love you because Jesus died. It works. The gospel is this. Because God the Father loves you, so Jesus died. In other words, how many of you moms and dads, when your kids were little, maybe you still do this because they're little now, had little ways of talking about how much you love them? I love you to the moon and back. I love you this much. Did you have those little games you played, you know, little things you say to them? How many of you did that? I did it. I still do it. My kids are like, okay. You know, they're old now. The cross is God's answer to that question. How much does Dad love you? How much does the Father love you? This much. This much. In what way does God love you? Fully, completely. Full sacrifice. How much does he love you? This is how we know this. Remember the sacrifice of God's substitute. D.A. Carson writes about this. He says, imagine a conversation. Imaginary conversation between two Jewish Israelite men the night before the Passover. Let's call them Eli and Saul, two good Jewish names. Eli says to Saul, are you scared about tonight? And Saul says, no. Haven't you put the blood over the lintel and the door frames? Yeah, I've done all that. Then you have nothing to worry about, Eli says. Saul says, but still, I mean, a lot of stuff, crazy stuff's been happening. Have you been paying attention? I mean, blood, rivers to blood, boils, locusts, frogs, I mean, it's scary stuff. And Saul says, have you done what God instructed you to do? Yes. Then you have nothing to fear. Well, that's easy for you to say. You have four sons. I've only got one. I mean, what if the angel of death makes a mistake? Gets the address wrong? God doesn't make mistakes. Yeah, well, all I can tell you is I'll be glad when this night is over. And they both go to bed. The question is, which of those two men's son is spared? Which one's son is spared? Both. Why? Because their salvation, their deliverance, has nothing to do with how perfect their faith is, how confident they are, whether or not they ever question or struggle. It has everything to do and only to do with the blood of the Lamb. That's it. Now, which of you hasn't at times, or me included, hasn't wrestled with, does God really love me? Does he really forgive me? I mean, does he forgive me again? This is like the 250,000th time I've had to confess this. Does he love me really for this? I mean, is it possible with all my past, with the dysfunction in my family, with all that I've been, could he really love me? How many of you haven't thought that and wrestled with it and deeply questioned and even doubted it? This is God's answer. Remember Pharaoh's question in Exodus 5? Who is this God that I should listen to him? What makes this God so unique? The Passover is God's answer to that question. This is how I love you. 1 John 4 tells us this in 9 and 10. This is how we know what love is, that God sent his son into the world to be an atoning sacrifice for our sins. That's how you know. That's the ground of all human assurance before God. Not how much of the Bible you've memorized, not how often you come to church, not how much you give, not how many times you do acts of service. The way you know that God loves you is one way only, the death of Jesus Christ in your place. That's how you know. That's what Passover is pointing to. Third thing to remember. So first, remember the severity of God's mercy. We all owe a debt of sin that we can't pay. Second, remember the substitute in your place. And third, remember the power of God's deliverance. Remember the power of God's deliverance. One of the most amazing things to me about this story, and I not really paid attention to it until studying for this sermon. I mean, I knew it was there, but you ever have that experience? You've read something 100 times and suddenly something clicks. You hear it in a way you never heard it before? That happened for me. Reading this story, in verse 14, in verse 17, in verse 26, and verse 27, God says to the Israelites, to his people, through Moses, he says, this is to be a celebration, a remembrance. Prepare this meal. Spread this blood. remember this night. And they're going to eat this dinner when? They're going to eat this Passover meal when? After? The next morning? Is it breakfast? After the angel of death comes? Before. They're going to spread the blood before. They're going to have this meal with this Passover lamb before God delivers them. Are you listening? God is saying to his people, then and now, I want you to remember and celebrate your victory in me before I deliver you. How do you celebrate deliverance from slavery when you're still in bondage? How do you celebrate freedom from sin when you still struggle with it? That's what we're called to do. God says to you, I want you to remember who I am. I want you to celebrate what I've done before you fully experience it. The Israelites have not had the angel of death pass over. They have not had the Red Sea parted. They have not yet left the land of Egypt. They're going to, but not yet. And God says, celebrate it anyway, because you're going to walk in it. And I think he says that to us. Now, I'm not talking about like prosperity gospel here. If we just believe it, then we're going to have it. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm saying God wants to do things in your life, deliver you from the shame and fear of your past, deliver you out of your present struggle, bring you out of the despair and discouragement and sense of loss you have. He wants to do things in your life, and he wants you to count on it now, to believe it now, even though you haven't fully realized it, fully experienced it. What does Paul say in 1 Corinthians 11 when he tells us how we're to celebrate the Lord's Supper, which is an adapted Passover? He says, as often as you eat the bread and drink the cup, you are proclaiming the Lord's death and resurrection until what? He returns. He hasn't returned yet. Celebrate it, because he's going to. Remember it, because he's going to. I think that's true in our own lives as well. Remember the power of God's deliverance, even in the midst of your struggle. Because we do not count our victory based on our circumstances. In fact, last week, if you were here, you heard Pastor Brian and Pastor Andrew Griffiths. He was at East Campus, so you didn't hear him. But he has a funny British accent. You might remember him. Anyway, they talked about the I will statements of God in Exodus 6. And those I will statements, those four statements of I will that God says to his people, they make up what's called the four cups of the Passover Seder. First, the cup of salvation. God says, I will bring you out of Egypt. I'm going to save you. I'm going to change your condition. Objective change to your condition. You will no longer be slaves. I'm bringing you out. That's salvation. The second cup is what's called, God says in Exodus 6, the next part of the verse, he says, not only will I bring you out, I'm going to deliver you from your bondage. The cup of deliverance. Now, what's the difference between salvation and deliverance? Well, I remember I learned this lesson from a man that I met in Angola. I talked about Angola prison in Louisiana many times, but this particular man, and I just corresponded with him actually a couple of months ago. He went in at 18 years old for first-degree murder, and he was set free because of DNA evidence after 30 years in prison, 48 years old. 30 years. 30 of his 48 years on this earth he spent behind bars. And I read something he wrote. He's now traveling, talking about his experience. He said, I spent almost all of my adult life behind bars. Even though I am now free, I no longer live in the prison, I don't know how to behave as a free person. I don't know how to live as a free person. I've got to be retrained. And I think what God says, I will save you. I'm going to set you free. You're no longer in Egypt. But I'm going to deliver you, meaning I'm going to train you how to think as a free person because of my grace. I'm going to retrain you how to live in my grace as totally free. Because we're conditioned to live the other way, aren't we? Many of us, though we believe in Jesus, still live as if we're prisoners. And then the third cup is the cup of redemption. I will redeem you, Jesus says. Meaning, your salvation, your deliverance, come at a price. They're not free. It's free to you, but it's not free. And so I'm going to pay for it. To redeem is to buy back. I'm going to buy your salvation. I'm going to purchase your deliverance. And so we celebrate the cup of redemption. And most scholars think when Jesus is at the Passover, the Last Supper in Luke 22, when he says, I eagerly desire to eat this Passover with you, and he holds up a cup, it's the third cup that he's holding up, the cup of redemption. Meaning, what's coming, right? Celebrate it before it happens. What's coming is, I'm going to purchase all this. This cup is the new covenant, he says, in my blood, shed for the forgiveness of your sins. And the fourth cup, the cup of praise. Meaning, when you begin to realize that my condition's been changed, and I've been delivered from this old way of life, and it's been paid for by Jesus fully. I don't have to earn it. Then your heart is moved to praise, sometimes referred to as the cup of consummation. And so we celebrate it now, and we'll celebrate it fully one day. That's what that most scholars think when Jesus says, I will not drink of this vine, until the fruit of the vine, until I see you again. He's referring to the cup of praise. The consummation is coming. The full realization of all these things is coming. This is the picture, these cups, of what God has accomplished for us, what the blood of the Lamb does. Saves you, delivers you, redeems you, and brings you to praise. So that's three things to remember. The severity of God's mercy. We all owe a debt of sin we can't pay. The sacrifice of the substitute. Somebody pays for you. And third, the power of the deliverance. All that's been accomplished by Jesus. And the fourth thing is something not to remember but to behold. Behold the glory of the Lamb of God. On the night before his death, Jesus is observing the Passover meal. And in that meal, we are familiar with this, he takes the unleavened bread, the bread made in haste, the matzah, Jews call it, and he stands up as he would have done as the one presiding over the meal, and he breaks it as is done in the Jewish tradition. And they would have expected him to say, this is the bread of our affliction. Our ancestors left in haste and suffered in the wilderness so we could be delivered. We could experience freedom. Jesus doesn't say that. He says, this is my body. In other words, this is the bread of my affliction, he says. I'm going to suffer so that you can experience ultimate deliverance, ultimate freedom. This is my body, and it's given for you. By the way, did you know that in a Passover Seder, one of the traditions is to take a portion of the broken matzah, and it's called the afikomen, and to wrap it up and to hide it until the end of the meal? This is like a little aside, you know? And then at the end of the meal, the children have to search for it and bring it back. And the body, right? The matzah is then, which is wrapped in white linen, is brought back, taken out of the white linen, and celebrated. What does that sound like? Jesus says, I'm giving this whole thing new meaning. All that you've been celebrating and remembering back then is pointing to something that you can barely comprehend that I'm about to do. And the three elements of the Seder meal, Passover meal, the three central elements, there's bitter herbs, and there's something called the karoset, which is like to represent mortar, that they were making bricks with mortar, and there's a whole bunch of other symbols that have been added over the centuries. But the three central elements right there in the text are the cup, the unleavened bread, and the lamb. This is not a lamb bone. This would be like a mutant lamb. This is a giant bone. But you wouldn't be able to see a lamb bone, so I got a huge whatever this is. Dinosaur bone. I wanted you to see it. The Paschal lamb, the roast lamb, the Passover lamb, is the very center of the meal. Now, do you notice that in the Passover accounts, the accounts of Jesus' Passover, he talks about the bread, my body. He talks about the cup, my blood. He never talks about the lamb. It's not even mentioned. He never instructs them where to find the lamb. He never tells them that they're going to slaughter the lamb. Most scholars think there was no lamb at this meal. Certainly not mentioned. Why not? There's no lamb on the table. Because the lamb is sitting at the table. This is what John the Baptist means in John chapter 1, verse 29, when he sees Jesus and by the Spirit of God says, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Behold. You'll see this image here of the blood. Remember, they're supposed to put the blood where? On the lintel, on the doorposts. The lintel and the doorposts. What does that remind you of? The lintel and the doorposts. The cross. The people of God in Egypt, in the ancient moment when the angel passed over, the mark that they belonged to God was the blood over their life. For those of us today, the mark that we belong to Jesus is not how much money you give, not how often you come to church, not how faithful you are in service, not how much you know about the Bible, not how spiritual you are, none of those things. The mark you belong to Jesus is simply the cross. The blood of the Lamb over your life. That's it. Then you're his. Loved perfectly by him. I mentioned before that you could see the whole story of God as the story of the Lamb. in the early on, we discovered that there's a sacrifice that needs to be made for sin. Remember Abraham and Isaac? God says, sacrifice your son, which sounds crazy to us. But Abraham, though it was horrifying, knew there was a debt that's paid, and the firstborn is to be called in for payment of the debt. And when Isaac says to his father, where's the lamb? I see the wood, I see the fire, where's the lamb? What does Abraham say? God himself will provide the lamb. The next chapter, chapter 2, we read in Exodus that there is actually a substitute. Chapter 1, we all owe a debt of sin we can't pay. Chapter 2, there's a substitute that pays for you. Chapter 3, the New Testament, the Passover, Jesus is that substitute. But that's not the last chapter, is it, in the story of the Lamb? The last chapter comes to us in the last book of the Bible, the book of Revelation. The Lamb we've been hearing about in different cryptic ways and amazing ways comes back to us in Revelation chapter 5, verse 6. And between the throne and the four living creatures and among the elders, I saw a lamb standing as though it had been slain. A lamb with the marks of its sacrifice. And chapter 7, verse 17. For the lamb in the midst of the throne will be their shepherd, and he will guide them to springs of living water, and God will wipe away every tear from their eye. Story of the lamb is you and I owe a debt of sin we can't pay. There is a substitute that God provides. Jesus Christ is that substitute. And the final chapter that we celebrate even today, though it hasn't happened fully yet, is that he sits on the throne. And he makes all things right. He wipes away every tear. He rights every wrong. That is the heart of this crazy ancient story in this meal. And some of you here, I'll leave you this challenge. You know, 1 week from today, you're going to come back for Easter. And you're going to dress nicer than you are now. You know, you're going to put on your Easter clothes. And you're going to come and do the Easter thing. Worship, you want it to be awesome, you're gonna go home, and you're gonna eat chocolate bunnies till you get sick and open eggs and whatever else you do. I want to challenge you to this week, make it a priority to behold the Lamb. What does that mean? Behold doesn't just mean, oh, look, there it is. It means to take in focused concentration of your mind and heart, to think deeply about who God is and what he's done. And some of you here you're struggling with this. Does God love me? Could God love me? And beholding the Lamb means to recognize that the answer to that question is yes, because of Jesus. And some of you here are in the midst of struggle going, how do I celebrate deliverance and freedom when life is hard? And God is saying to you, you celebrate who I am and what I'm going to do, even in the midst of your struggle, because of Jesus, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world, your sin and my sin. Sets us free. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this amazing story. We confess that we're awfully busy and distracted people. And you call us now to remember the severity of your mercy, the debt we owe, the sacrifice of your substitute in our place, the amazing power of your deliverance. And Lord, between this Sunday and next Sunday, help us to behold the Lamb of God who takes away our sin. We praise you, we thank you. Amen. I feel like that's just practicing for next Sunday. So come back and worship with us as we celebrate the resurrected King. If you're here this morning, before I pronounce the benediction and dismiss you, if you'd like someone to pray with you or pray for you for any reason, particularly if you want to know the hope that is available to you in Jesus Christ, members of the prayer team will be right down here. Come talk with us. We'd love to encourage you through prayer. Now, brothers and sisters, go in the grace of the Lamb of God who takes away your sin, my sin, and the sin of the world. His name is Jesus. To him be glory now and forever. Amen.